I'm going to talk today about recent wildfire trends and strategies for adaptation in the U.S. And first, we'll discuss recent trends in wildfire in the U.S. and look at an overview of wildfire management policy and strategies for adaptation to wildfire. So since 1960, we've seen a steady rise in the annual area burned across the U.S. And since 2000, this increase in area burned has risen markedly. The top 10 years with the largest area burned since 1960 across the U.S. have all occurred since 2000. So for example, 2015 was the number one most area burned since 1960. 2017 was number two, and you can see those numbers above the bars. This increase in area burned has been associated with warming across the U.S., where the total area burned you see in red, as we saw in the last slide, and the annual average temperatures across the U.S. in black show rising trend lines over this 1960 to 2017 period. So these trends are not uniform, however, across the U.S. If you see in the inset over on the far right, that some areas have experienced very little change, for example, in the southeast over this time period, while areas of the north and the west and Alaska have experienced the most warming. So of the area burned across the U.S., the majority, some two-thirds, burns in the west. And with much of the recent increases that I just described are also occurring across the west, as you see on the map on the right. So when we talk about wildfire trends, the West plays a really big role. In particular, in the West, since the 1970s, the increase in area burned has been associated with warming of almost 2 degrees Fahrenheit. Snow melt, which protects the high country from drying out, is occurring 1 to 4 weeks earlier. And the fire season has extended about 3 months longer. Perhaps contrary to many people's perceptions, most of the area burned in the U.S. is low severity. So here we see area burned across the West from 1984 to 2014, and it's divided up by fire severity as determined by monitoring trends in burn severity. And the yellow and the green are about 65% of the total area burned across the U.S. during this time period. High severity is only 12% of this area. Moderate severity, another 23. So together, those sum to only about a third over this time period. So importantly, while we see increases in total area burned over this period, and there are no significant relative increases in the proportion of fires burning at high severity. Now, ignitions also play an important role in recent wildfire trends. Excellent work done by Jennifer Balch at CU's Earth Lab and colleagues, including postdoc Chelsea Nagy, have found that 84% of U.S. wildfires and 44% of the area burned since the 90s has been ignited by human-related activities. So on the left, you see lightning in blue ignites wildfires roughly May through September, but warming has enabled humans to successfully ignite wildfires essentially year-round, as you see in the red. And as a consequence, as you see on the map, much of the largest fires across the U.S. are human-ignited. So the last driver of recent trends in wildfires we'll discuss is fuel buildup. I'm going to discuss this in the context primarily of the western U.S., where you see on the left, open, dry pine forests historically experienced frequent, say every couple of years, low severity fires. These are ground fires that kill smaller, less fire-resistant trees. These kept these forests, dry forests, open with low densities of large trees that can withstand low severity fire. Now, with effective suppression of these low severity fires, smaller trees grew in, as you see on the right, making forests much denser. So today, if they burn, they're much more likely to burn at high severity due to high fuel loads. So many of you may be familiar with the outline of this story, which has been documented through careful fire history research. However, in talking to people, I realized that this lesson has probably been overlearned. So many people believe that this scenario applies to all forests in the West. Fuels buildup, however, only applies to typically dry ponderosa pine forests. They often are found at lower elevations. Fuels buildup has not occurred, for example, in moist forests or in cool, high elevation forests that burn relatively infrequently and at high severity. That's business as usual for those forests, and it's not a consequence of fuels buildup or due to past fire suppression. So to put fuels buildup and associated increases in fire severity that I just described in a broader national context, it's important to remember that most areas across the U.S. burn at low severity. Fuels buildup is indeed a concern for the particular forests I just described, but reducing such buildup will likely have relatively limited impact on broad-scale national trends in fire severity and burned area, which includes significant burning of non-forest vegetation, such as shrublands and grasslands. So as wildfire has increased over recent decades, so has the wildland-urban interface, or the WUI. And this is the zone where homes and wildland vegetation meet or intermingle, which is about 10% of the conterminous U.S. So work by Volker Radiloff and colleagues has carefully mapped the WUI across the U.S. From 1990 to 2010, they found that the number of homes in the wildland-urban interface grew by 41% to some 43 million homes, and the area expanded by 33%. So the majority of structure loss to wildfire, as you see on the map, has occurred in the arid West, even though most of the WUI is in the eastern U.S. It just doesn't burn as frequently in the east. Now, if that changes, we're going to be in big trouble. Just think Gatlinburg, Tennessee in 2016. So CoreLogic estimates that some 1.8 million homes in the western U.S. are currently at high or extreme risk of wildfire damage. So that totals about $500 billion in property value at risk. So further WUI growth will drastically increase our wildfire risk. So protecting people and homes in the WUI is indeed costly and dangerous, and both the risks and the costs are on the rise. Aside from suppression costs and home loss, about half of the true costs of wildfire are borne by the community affected by wildfire directly. And there are cascading impacts on businesses, infrastructure, evacuations, smoke, post-fire flooding, and debris flows, to name a few. So climate change is already affecting wildfires. Work by John Abatsoglu and Park Williams have demonstrated that since 1985, more than 50% of the area of the increase in the area burned by wildfires in the western U.S. forest have been attributed to anthropogenic climate change. So depending on our emission scenario, mid-century warming in the U.S. is projected to be on the order of 2 to 4 degrees Fahrenheit, likely greater than what we've already experienced in the last century. So this will be associated with significant further increases in wildfire in the near term. So the question is, how will we cope? So before we get to coping, I want to first review what our current policies are in addressing wildfire management. So the primary approach to wildfire management is suppression. We do this very effectively. We suppress the majority of wildfires. And suppression costs have exceeded 50% of the Forest Service total budget in recent years. And suppression costs have been rising dramatically. So we've reached $1 billion in federal suppression costs in 2000 for the first time. And it's already in 2017 that we've almost tripled that at $2.9 billion. This is the highest federal suppression cost we've ever witnessed. So on the heels of this record-breaking season, Congress recently committed to help cover rising costs of suppression that had been burdening the Forest Service. The other major policy approach to wildfire management is wildfire mitigation. So federal fuel reduction treatments such as prescribed fire and thinning, the aim is to reduce severity, not suppression. So suppression is, or prevention, that's what we discussed on the last slide. And this project of reducing fuels on federal lands is costs on the order of about $500 million per year. So analysis by Barnett and colleagues of federal fuel treatments, fuel reduction treatments across the U.S., and their results are corroborated by work that we did in Western forests, both show that very few treated areas encounter subsequent wildfire, less than 1% per year on average. So let me reiterate, the goal of these treatments is to reduce wildfire severity and help firefighters get in and better control those fires. But the vast majority of these treatments are not even encountering a wildfire during their, say, 10 to 20 year lifespan of effectiveness. So most treatments miss the opportunity to do their job. So for this reason, fuel reduction treatments are really unlikely to have broad US-wide impacts on fire severity or area burned. So what are some strategies for adaptation? So adaptation to wildfires when people and ecosystems adjust and reorganize in response to changing fire and climate to reduce their future vulnerability. So we can't keep just doing things like we've been doing. We need to add some new tools to our toolbox, new approaches that require that we build better, thin better, and burn better. So the National Institute of Building Sciences recently estimated that for every $1 spent on wildfire mitigation saves about $4 in wildfire disaster recovery costs. So significant investment in mitigation, wildfire mitigation writ large, by here I'm defining it as simply reducing the impact of future wildfires on communities. We need a significant investment. In response to the many climate-related disasters in 2017, significant funds have been allocated to support future disaster mitigation, some of them unprecedented. And frankly, this was a surprise, but it's a bright spot. While some of them are earmarked for hurricane recovery, I hope that communities with high fire risk will find ways to access some of these funds to better build and reduce future wildfire risks. So how do you build better? Primary way to do this is to integrate wildfire planning into regulations, codes, and ordinances, county by county, city by city, state by state. And such planning might involve restricting development to high fire-prone areas, retrofitting old homes and building new homes to withstand ignition, requiring defensible space, and reducing wildland fuels and creating fuel breaks on private lands near communities. Because 70% of the WUI is private land, so fuel reduction in the WUI cannot be effectively achieved through thinning on federal lands only. Furthermore, in order to build better, we need to realign incentives with risk, penalize those decisions that raise wildfire risk and reward decisions that reduce that risk. So in terms of penalties, shifting more wildfire protection and cost and responsibility to state, local, and private jurisdictions is one way that the high wildfire risk is more actively weighed against the benefits, say, of an increased tax base that comes with an expanding WUI. You can also shift wildfire responsibility away from poorly mitigated homes and sites. So wildfires may not risk their lives to save a home. That might change how people protect their homes in the WUI. Insurance is another lever. Rewarding decisions that reduce wildfire risk might involve tax breaks for reducing wildfire hazards, grants to communities to become more fire adapted. So some of these efforts are starting to happen, but they need to happen on a much larger scale. How can we thin better? So federal forest thinning cannot significantly alter these regional increases in area burned, which is tightly linked with climate, fire and fire weather. And they can't prevent home loss, which is primarily on private land, not federal land. We can thin better by thinning areas that burn more frequently to increase the encounter rates with wildfire and the opportunities to reduce fire severity. This will help ecosystems adapt to warming and reduce carbon losses from wildfire, which, for example, is a really big concern in areas like California. We can thin better by thinning on private land in and around communities to help firefighters directly defend homes and neighborhoods where ignitions are highest. And lastly, we can burn better. Allow more prescribed fires and remote wildfires to burn safely in ecosystems that have evolved with fire to help minimize the severity and size of future fires. We can reduce the number of human-related ignitions, especially in the WUI, where people and property are at high risk. And lastly, we can promote public awareness of the inevitability of wildfire. When wildfire occurs, it's always a surprise, but we can plan for it. And that's a key feature to adapting to increasing wildfire. So new adaptive approaches are needed to manage increases in wildfire risks and costs. Building, thinning, and burning better will help communities and ecosystems adapt to wildfire as climate continues to change. Thank you.